Oh, is that gonna work?
Yeah, well, we're gonna pray and then we're gonna worship the Lord today. And Brian's gonna give us testimony this morning for us. And then we're gonna be in Hebrews again. Hebrews 6. Bruce and them won't be here today. He said that his driveway was all icy, so he didn't figure he'd travel that far. So we'll keep them in our prayers. I love to be at church, amen. I love to see all your faces and your smiling faces and to know that we're all working together in the Spirit and God's moving. He is good. Father, we just want to thank you this morning for this church, Lord, and for what you're doing. We want to thank you for each and everybody that you brought here this morning and kept them safe. Lord, we just want to lift you up today. We want to magnify your name and give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God is good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Which one you sang it on up here?
Peter Paul Mary.
Yeah. You sang the good one? Yeah. Oh, you got one. Okay. Testing.
How do you want to turn me down? Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Glory, glory, glory. I'm King.
Hallelujah.
We didn't have him giving us life, we wouldn't be grieving.
Your love, oh Lord, reaches to heaven. Your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness like the mighty mountain.
Shadow of your
As we say, God is good all the time. God is good. Carl's going to bless us with a song.
Well, I wrote a song. And I got mixed up, see. I was falling in love, so I wrote a love song. And then I'm a Christian, and I wrote a gospel song, and I got it all intertwined.
Uh-huh.
Is that wrong?
No.
So you're going to get both versions today, and I'll hash it out later, all right? I'll fix it.
Jesus.
Amen.
Well, before I do this, I just
like to open up in prayer that these words be the words that God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit put on my heart. So please bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you today, beautiful, brisk Sunday morning. We give you all glory, honor, and praise. We glorify you, our Father. We glorify you, our Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray that the words that I share the congregation today are truth and thought, word, and deed, and that everything I say glorifies you, Father, and our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit. We pray, amen.
Amen.
Okay. I'm just going to kind of give you a brief testimony. First of all, I'd like to say, you know, this is what's the Holy Spirit is working through me is, of course, the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ and all. It's written in Psalms that the men and women, the heroes of the land have been in my life, in my faith, those of the Bible, our Lord Jesus Christ. This comes from the gospel according to John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word. Mm-hmm. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Mm-hmm. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him mm-hmm. was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth not. And that light is our Savior Jesus Christ. Just so you know, I am a disciple of Christ, and I claim all the benefits thereof, and that's first and foremost love is greatest. This is who sent me to testify to you today. As written in Exodus 3:14, God replied to Moses, I am who I am. Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And Jesus, of course, we know is a great I am, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And He is the Father of Jehovah, the Father of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I have not commanded you to be. Just a real quick thing. I was involved with drugs and alcohol, very bad. Living in carnal nature, flesh, and God through the Holy Spirit of conviction. And I won't go into the unspeakable acts as we're not supposed to in my sin. But I was living in just basically everything that would have condemned me to hell. And I know that. But I was living out in the country, and I was heading out there, and a guy says, Brian, or Jesus Christ himself, I believe, and said, Brian, you can't be double-minded because you know what will happen. And as I was leaving the driveway from a farm, I looked, and the sun was setting. And as the sun was setting, there was a line right through the middle. And we all know what happens if we're double-minded, you know, get you lukewarm. And so that started really to, not scare the bejesus out of me, it gave me the Holy Spirit, put Jesus in me. And as a result, you know, I struggled with it, but the Holy Spirit is a beautiful thing. I mean, my parents raised me in the church. I was raised Missouri Synod, but we're all parts of the body of Christ, you know, it doesn't matter. Doctrine. I mean, I don't think that we should argue about doctrine. We're all parts of the body of Christ, and Jesus Christ is the head.
Yeah.
Pure and simple. Period.
Yeah.
Anyway, my parents instructed me in the way to go, and I'm very grateful for that. I'm eternally grateful for that. You know, I was raised in the church, and I believe God loves us enough to discipline us, even in our simple nature, through the conviction of the Holy Spirit. Well. One thing, and because of my my sinful behavior, the lust of the flesh, even though I was raised in a Christian environment, my rebellion, it talks about rebellion, the rebellious lifestyle, I was the rebel. I had James Dean beat, okay? I was a rebel. And thus doing so, God convicted me of that rebellion, and what that rebellion was going to do is going to, it was going to send me to pits of hell. And I know that. Just so you know, I was living life on earth in hell because of my addiction. And because of turning my back on the truth of the gospel and the truth of deliverance through God's grace, mercy, and love and Christ Jesus our Savior. And boy, when you do that, boy, God puts you over His knee and He gives you a spanking. And And he always told me in the scripture, I had a parole violation right towards the end. I won't go into too much lengths, but he's, be strong and courageous. And do not, oh, I got it written down. Joshua, be strong. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not fear or be discouraged, for the Lord God is with you wherever you go. See, I was ODing on heroin and cocaine, and I felt my heart was about ready to explode. And I was in Fort Wayne, Indiana. I was walking, and the devil was after me. I'm not gonna say he wasn't. He was. He was trying to tempt me with everything he could underneath the fires of hell to try to take me there with him. And it was to a point where I was that man in Matthew 5, where I was the man in the cave with legion within me because of my rebellious and sin. And these scriptures, the scripture just shined out. It says, Brian, if you keep walking, you will die. He says, turn around and charge into him. And I thought of God's holy army, David and Joshua, and how just be strong and courageous, go into battle, win, lose, live as Christ, dies for gain. So, and don't you know, I got on my knees right there on the side of the highway in New Haven, Fort Wayne, and the sun was shining. The Bible instructs us that the sun that God created shines from one side of the tent to the other side of his tent up in heaven. And boy, that sun just hit me, and I believe it's our Lord Jesus Christ, the light of our Father through Christ Jesus. The Holy Spirit just, bam, hit me right in the head. And I give God all glory, honor, and praise on that. And of course, and this is all because God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever shall believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Nothing I do, I boast in them. Lord, you alone are my, and this is what God put me in the Wabash County Jail. I already had the felony here. It's level 6 in possession of cocaine. There's no shame to my game because I'm not in the game. But there's therefore not no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. None. I let the shame and guilt of my incarceration, addiction, it was a yoke upon my back, upon my neck, the shame I carried around for years. Jesus took that off because, he says, hey, my yoke is light, or my burden is light, my yoke is easy. And he took it off, and every once in a while I jump for Jesus. Just out of things. And I love doing it, okay? And it doesn't matter if you're in a wheelchair, it doesn't matter if you're sitting in a chair, just do a little jump for Jesus in your spirit. It puts a smile on your face. And the Lord my God is my rear guard. Okay, Proverbs 3:5-6, and this is something that I do. It keeps it simple in my life. Trust the Lord with all our heart, and lean not on their own understanding. In all your ways, you acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. And so it makes it simple for me, because I don't have to say, "Okay, man, I'm worried about the world." Because hey, let's be honest, folks. In the world today, everything Satan in the world, it's still kill and destroy everyone. It's selfish nature, it's the pride, it's the flesh. They glorify the flesh versus glorifying God. So that makes me think, if we're not in the end of days, well, guess what, we're almost. But have no fear, Jesus Christ is here. Not in me, but through the Father our God, and shines within us all. Just so you know, I take David's words, serious about when he stood against Goliath. I am a soldier of our Lord Father's heavenly army. I'm a soldier for Christ Jesus in love. And because as Paul wrote in 2 Timothy 1:7, for God did not give me the spirit of fear, but the power of love and of sound mind. See, God is love. Christ is love. And I believe as a disciple of Christ, I do believe in all the benefits thereof, and that's the healing power of the Spirit, the healing power of casting out demons, the power against Satan, the power of healing the ill, the sick. I believe that and I claim it. So I pray that we start laying some holy hands on people to glorify God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. It's not me. Like I said, I boast in him. Uh-huh. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And this is something that gave me courage throughout my struggles with sin and against the evil one. I take this very serious. This is they have in the mural out there, the painting, Ephesians 6, about my armor of God. Well, I got my armor of God on. Okay, I believe that. And first of all, I'm thinking my helmet of salvation. Thank you, Jesus. This comes from Romans 8:38. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creatures shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is Christ Jesus our Lord. See, 1 John 4:18, and this is my testimony, but it's through Scripture. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear has torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. Okay, so I don't live in fear what the world says. I don't live in fear what Satan says. Hey, get thee behind me, Satan. You better make sure I don't pull out my sword and go at you. And that's who I am. I am a soldier of our Lord. Hey, I'm a Christian soldier. They made a song, Onward Christian Soldiers. And I fight Satan with that sword every day, every night. If he sees me rebuking him, that means I got my sword and I'm going for him. See, but it's the sword of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit of love. And it won't slam. It just silences them. It, because light overpowers darkness. It always has, always will. And it's the love. It's like love your enemy. It's like what pouring wet hot coals upon their head. So I can fight in love and knowing that, and guess what? I always say, well, Lord God, if I did anything wrong, I always say, forgive me. And guess what? God says, hey, keep marching on, son. Okay, and this is what I really love. Therefore, there's no accommodation for those in Christ. Just, I am a disciple of Christ. I like to reiterate that because I like the sound of it. And you, brothers and sisters, disciples of Christ, too, read it. God is faithful. Jesus said, ask my Father whatever you shall want, and you shall receive it. Basically, ask what you receive, Matthew 7:7. Ask, you shall receive. Knock at that door, shall be opened unto you. So I ask anything I need of my Father, and I know that my Father is faithful to supply all my needs according to the Scriptures. Okay, and this is the Great Commission. Now it comes from Matthew. I'll read that. But I've been commissioned by our Heavenly Father in Christ Jesus, my Savior, to testify the truth of their word, being filled with their heavenly Holy Spirit of love to all nations, for both the rebellious and the righteous. See, Paul said he's the chief of all sinners, but I'm the one that beat them out. But guess what? We're all saved by the grace and mercy of God the Father through Christ Jesus our Savior. So we are holy because they are holy. The light of our Father in heaven shines through me from our Savior Christ Jesus, the testimony of the truth. I do that through a smile. And I do that through a... Everyone raise up your right hand right now. Raise them up. And just in spirit, high five for Jesus. Ready? 1, 2, 3. You feel the Holy Spirit just run through you. Okay? And that's clear to them. That's the Holy Spirit. And just, you know, I say this in all praise and thanks to God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Why you ask? Because let me read something. Psalm 63:3. And this is from David, a man after God's own heart. You can only pray to be so, but a man or a woman. God, your unfailing love is better than life itself. Oh, well, I praise you. I praise you as long as I live. You shall satisfy me more than the richest feast. I will sing praise. I will praise you with songs of joy. And see, I have hope for all. And I have hope that we go out there and pray for the ministry here, church, and the ministry you're going to be doing, the ladies' shelter. And you ask me why I have all this hope and love. I'll tell you one thing. Because, you know, God, love covers multitudes. And in 2 Corinthians, love never fails.
to go into the jails on Tuesday night when Brian was there and hear him talk about the word. And you could tell he was excited.
Amen.
And, hi, sweetheart. It was just good to hear that he was on fire. You know, so our ministry, Chrissy's ministry, and ours in the jail, does do something. You know, we go in there in the hopes that God will grab a heart. And he does. He grabs them. And it might take a while, but sometimes they might go back out, but eventually they come back. Eventually they come back. If you will bear with me just for a moment, I'd like to pray real quick. Precious Heavenly Father, I just thank you, Lord, for today. I thank you for the testimony that we heard.
Yes.
I thank you, Lord, that you brought a dear loved one tonight. And I thank you for the life, Lord, and I thank you for the work you're going to do. I see a bright future ahead, and I see hope. And Lord, there's open arms of love, multitudes of love here. And we just want to love this person, Jesus. Jesus' name. Desiree, honey, when you come in your house, I'm sorry if I'm... Hi. Desi is a sweet girl that I've missed and worked with. That's good. Can you hear me? That is good. I'll try to talk loud. Still have to grab this. We're going to be in Hebrews today, and I don't know how long we'll go, but I'm going to try to get through 8 verse 8. But you know, when a baby is born, it has all the equipment that it needs to grow. It isn't born and then grows arms and legs. It's born with those. So the older a child gets, the more he uses what he's been given to grow. God gives us things when we're born again. Born new person, when we ask him in our heart, he then gives us gifts to grow. And the ultimate goal, I believe, as a church, is to allow you all to use the gifts that God has given you so that you will grow spiritually. Amen. Now, you know, I hear people say, well, I don't have anything. God, I don't do nothing good. You know, I don't know what gift I have. Well, maybe we should do a quiz, find out what your gifts are if you feel that way. But you know, there's times I see people just going out of their way to help other people and just really take groceries to the house, open the car door for them, open the door out front. Well, they have a gift of hospitality.
Yeah.
Sometimes you don't recognize your own gifts. So the same principle as we're going to be going through is that he wanted them to understand they needed to mature and grow. We have a lot of stagnant churches around that they come every Sunday and hear a message. And they go home. And that's okay because you're hearing the Word of God and the Word of God is going to birth seed in you. But to grow over from the milk that the Word talks about, we need to start using what God has given us. Some of us have a gift to just figure things out of how to build something. That's a gift to be able to work that out in your mind. Amen? Some of us is a walking computer, and my husband is a mathematician. I mean, he's a calculator. Plain and simple. He's a calculator. I mean, that is a God-given gift.
Yep.
And some of us can just see things in our mind. The Lord shows them. That's a gift, to see visions like that. It's a gift to hear a word from the Lord. It's a gift to have faith. Amen?
Amen.
It's a gift to have hope in your heart for a better future. Amen? The foundation for the Hebrews' faith, it had been laid for them. But they never built on that faith. If you have faith, but you never step out and use it, then you never receive it. Well, Carl, what if you'd have been looking at Kathy? You know, oh, I really would like to go out with her. And I have faith that she'd like me, but I'm afraid to ask her out. What if you would have never took that step to ask her out?
I can't say it.
Faith. You got to step forward. You have to move forward. God doesn't want us to stay where we're at. When we stay comfortable, we're stagnant. Do you know that? We're stinky, foul water because we're not moving. We're not stirring the gift. We're letting it just lay there. There's a lot of comfortable people sitting in churches today. And that's fine and dandy, but we need to be using what God has given us. He always wants us to move forward. So I'm going to read verses, let's just do the first one. And I'm reading from the New American Standard Version, Hebrews 6:1. Therefore, leaving the elementary teaching about the Christ or Messiah, let us press on to maturity or perfection, some translations say, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God. First, it lists three things here. Repentance from dead works and faith toward God. Dead works. Well, what is that? What's dead works? We're trying to earn God's favor. We work, go to this nursing home, we go to that jail, we go here, we're working, we're doing everything within our own power to please, to do things for God, to please Him. Those are dead works if we're not doing them out of the Holy Ghost's power. See, God is the one that places the call. He's the one that's going to press in there in your heart and press something on you. Press a ministry on you. Press a calling on you. That's when you move. You don't try to earn His love. Because God's love cannot be bought. It's a free gift. Sometimes dead works can be right by rituals. Like our brother was talking about doctrines in churches. There's some churches where they have to stand up and they read a prayer out of a book. There's some they have to wear the robe or a tradition of they have to sing a certain amount of songs before they come in or they pass the plate. There's all kinds of traditions and rules. Those aren't led by the Spirit, those are man-made things. And they're not all bad. I mean, sometimes when you grow up like in the doctrinal church, it teaches you discipline. And we all need discipline. But when we feel like we can't get to God without doing something a certain way, that's when it becomes a problem. Because God is with us all the time.
Man.
Dead in the sense that they could not save a person. And every member of the Hebrew church has spent plenty of time on the treadmill of religion. Would you say that? I mean, look at the Pharisees and the Sadducees back in the day. They had the big headdress and the capes, and they had all these rules, regulations, 600 and some, that you had to do to be perfect in their eyes. Do you think that we could have did that? No. 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 I'd have failed the first day. But they looked the part, didn't they? They looked all spiritual. They looked all like they were, know what they were talking about. They had the suit on. You know, sometimes you can even be intimidated today when you go in a room and there's a man that's got a suit on. He's got like $600 shoes and, you know, he's dolled up and you think, oh, well, I better watch what I say around this guy. But he's a person, same as you and I. No better, no worse. He might wear a different kind of clothes, but underneath he's the same. Amen? Don't let anybody intimidate you like that. Even a religious person. Don't let them intimidate you. He's the God Almighty, the great I Am. He's the one we need to be concerned about. The Holy Ghost is the one that we need to put our care upon and look upon. Not no other man or no other woman. We don't need to please nobody but the Lord. And if you put Him number one in your heart, everything else is going to fall in place. The problem is we don't put Him number one. We go off doing our own thing, wanting our own way, thinking we're doing this for God or doing that for God. And all what we've done is we've built our own little idol game going around. We need to look to the Lord for the answer. Because He's number one. The Hebrews, they knew the shallowness and the deadness of trying to please God through rituals. We can't please God through words. You know, it's the love of God in us that wants us to do things for people, to do things out of love for people. Carl goes and plays because he loves to go and play in the nursing home. Well, God put that in his heart to go play in the nursing home. Mm-hmm. And repentance. This verse talks about repentance. Now, what's repentance mean? Turn. Go the other way. Don't keep going around that mountain. Don't keep going back. You know, sometimes in the jail, you know, I've done it now for what, 8 years, I think, and sometimes I see them come in four times, you know, same person, and you're going, hey, did you not learn? You know, did you not learn? Did you not? But it's still a process to get to the mark. See. And I thought about this, and I told Brian, you know, it's like a dog going back to the vomit. Mm-hmm. That's what I think about drugs and alcohol. I think of it as vomit. It's sick, and it's disgusting, mm-hmm. and it's killing our body. It's poison.
Yep.
It's poison. Mm-hmm. But you know what? My husband told me that, because he's a ex-alcoholic. You know, he drank for 20 years in East St. Louis, and he told me a story of he felt like it was just poison going in his arm, and he could, and once he had so many drinks, he could just, you know, feel it pump into his heart.
Yeah.
It was working. It's like, keep going back to that thing. And it kills you. And it kills you. And you want to quit, but you can't get away from it. Repentance means to turn. Man, you've got to make up your mind, this is it. This is it. I'm done. I'm not going back. I'm going to get rid of all them old friends. I'm going to get rid of all that old dress. I'm going to change my whole looks, everything about me. I'm going to move clear wherever. Whatever you got to do to make the change, make the change. God will be there right with you. Find good people, stand behind you, and they will. But it's turning to Christ. You can't do it on your own. None of us can do it on our own. You know, we have a Celebrate Life Recovery on Thursday nights, and I like the thing that Carol says. You know, she didn't have a problem with alcohol anymore or anything, but she said, I still struggle from life issues. Life issues. Sometimes life just kicks you in the butt. And we need that extra encouragement from one another. We should always be lifting each other up and encouraging each other. You know, we fail as people. We're human. We make mistakes. But the Holy Ghost, Jesus Christ, still loves us. And He's there for us. Everything we go through, He's there for us. Verses 2 and 3. Of instruction about washings and laying on of hands and the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this will do if God permits. Most churches are set up to preach topically, which, you know, is okay, but the problem is they pick this topic one week. Like, we're gonna talk on holiness this week. Next week, they may talk on gossiping or lying. Then the next week after that, they might talk about the story of David and the war, Noah. You know, we've all heard the certain stories of the Bible. The problem with that is that you don't grow through the Word. I think that a lot of churches that aren't spiritual maturity today is not because of the people, it's because of the church doesn't teach the Word of God. There's a lot more in this Bible than just the stories that you hear. A lot more. And it has a lot more deeper meaning for your life, for our life. I think growing through the Word just plain and simple grows us up. If I was training to be a doctor and they only taught me about the head, trained me in every way of the head, but yet they didn't teach me about the feet, and I had a foot problem, and I had to go into the doctor that all he ever learned about was the head, now, how's that going to work? You know, I can hear all the stories about Noah, and I can hear all the stories about David, and the mighty, powerful stories about the Red Sea being crossed. But if I don't hear the rest of the story, I need to grow up. You know what I mean? And there's some of you sitting in here today that need to grow up. Read the Word. And you know, there's a lot of good study things out there today that you can get to study. We're living in a time and a generation where it's all the iPads and everything else. There's a lot of good teachings that you can get commentaries online now that tell you backgrounds of what each word means. And you know, get yourself a Strong's Concordance. Look up those words. Find out what they mean. It's your life. It's your soul. It's my job to lead the sheep. It's my job to tell you, grow up. Quit going over there to that fence and trying to get out, because that wolf over there is going to get you if you don't. I mean, it's my job to tell you, grow up. get in the Word of God and study the Word of God. Get a Strong's Concordance. Take time. Just don't read it. Study it. Go deeper. Go deeper. Excuse me. Verses 4 through 8. For in the case of those who have once been enlightened and have tasted of the heavenly gift and have been made partakers of the Holy Spirit and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the age to come and then have fallen away, it is impossible to renew them again to repentance. Since they again crucified to themselves the Son of God and put him to open shame, foreground the drinks, the rain, which often fall on it and brings forth vegetation useful to those for whose sake it is also tilled, receives a blessing from God. But if it yields thorns and thistles, it is worthless and close to being cursed. And it ends up being burned. Now, I've heard a lot of, you know, there's some churches that teach that that means that, okay, if you've asked Jesus in your heart, and he's came in and he saved your soul, and then you went out and you backslid and you went back out into the world and you've sinned, and sinned badly, then you can't ever come back and be born again. You can't ever receive Jesus Christ. You're just doomed to go to hell. You know, there's some churches that teach that, that that's what this verse means. That is not what this verse means. Well, look at Peter for one. When he denied the Lord, he came back. Amen?
Amen.
He came back. God forgave him. Amen?
Amen.
And then, but there is a difference between Judas and Peter, would you say?
Mm-hmm.
Peter was repentant. Judas what? Scripture also says that a righteous man falls 7 times, but he rises again. I don't know about you, but in my lifetime, hey, I've known the Lord and I've backslid. I've known the Lord and I've done what I wanted to do and backslid again. I'd backslid in. I remember, I hate to even say this, but I remember drinking beer before I went into a church service, thinking they couldn't smell it on me. Because I had some, mouthwash. Why do we think that we're fooling these people? They all knew. They all knew that they still loved me. They didn't kick me out. They still love me. Amen?
Yeah.
Hey, I'm sure that some of them was dealing with some life issues. The scripture here is actually talking to the Hebrew people. And they were mixing Judaism and Christianity. And then they got to where they were like not totally accepting what Jesus did on the cross, and going back to sacrifices. Mm-hmm. Now that is a blatant blasphemy when you do that. It's like saying, oh well, he was human, but what he did on that cross just isn't quite good enough to get my sin, because my sin is the worst sin. I've done everything bad in this world. Everything disgusting that you could think of, I've done. I've aborted a child. I've slept with all kinds of men. I rape people. I mean, I'm just, paraphrasing here and using things, but there's sometimes people think that they've done so much bad that God can't ever forgive them. But I'm here to tell you something. Jesus Christ can forgive you. No matter what you've been through, no matter what you have done, he will forgive you.
Amen.
Amen. He will come back in your heart and he will set your life on fire if you will let him do the work.
Amen.
And I told Brian the other day, I was taking him to Fort Wayne. I said, you know what? God's going to move mountains. He can move mountains for you. He can push them right out of the way. There's things that God can do in your life that you'll just be amazed. but he expects you to bring your shovel.
Amen.
Yes. You got to do some work too. Amen. He says, I'm going to remember that. I like that. And I got that from old Bill. And I've never forgot that. We still have choices. See, God still gives us free will. It's us that makes the wrong choices. This difficult passage is best understood in the content of Hebrews 6, 1 and 2. The writer to the Hebrews means that if they retreat back to Judaism, that all religious repentance, it's not going to do them any good. Because once they start sacrificing an animal again, they've made their choice. They've blasphemed against the Holy Ghost. They've said he wasn't good enough. My Jesus is good enough. Amen?
Amen.
Let's give him a praise. Clap your hands. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God is good enough. When it says there, if they fall away. See, we can backslide, fall. Righteous man can fall 7 times. But it didn't say fall away 7 times.
Yeah.
You see, there's a meaning there in a way. There's a difference there. Falling away means falling away from the sacrifice he did for us on the cross. That little word away means that they reject him. They rejected him. I don't know about you, but I hold on to him every day because I mess up. And sometimes I feel like I shouldn't be behind this pulpit. But God says, go on. And I'm like, why? He says, go on. You see, that's the thing about faith is, what did God like about Abraham? He had the faith. He had the faith. And what's faith mean? Trust. You got to trust God. You got to trust him with everything. You got to trust he's going to work your life out. You got to trust that you're going to have hope for a future. You got to trust that you're going to be able to break that addiction. You got to trust that God's going to move mighty mountains in your life. And he's going to get you a job. And you're going to be able to do the things that he wants you to do because he's placed it in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Amen.
You know, there's someone here who's been sitting on something for a long time, and they keep saying, you know, I think I ought to do that. Because God keeps pressing in their heart that they're supposed to, but they keep hanging on to something. Gotta let it go. You gotta let it go. You know, we can't give up. We have to move forward. Because it's about the seeds that are planted. Verses 7 and 8. For the earth which drinks in the rain that often comes upon it and bears herbs useful for those by whom it is cultivated receives blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and thistles and briars, it is rejected and near to being cursed, whose end is to be burned. Is there anybody in here today that really wants to go to hell?
No.
I mean, seriously, one burn for the rest of your life, huh? I don't. What is coming out of your life is the evidence of what's going on in your heart, you know. Things that are coming out of your life is the evidence of what's going on in your heart. You know, most of you in here today, I can see God working in your heart. And that's an awesome thing for a pastor. I mean, I see Christy's faithfulness to come. And I see Helen's desire to work with women and Harold. And Brian's testimony of where God's brought him from.
Mm-hmm.
And all the wonderful things that the rest of you are doing in the spirit. Joyce, just letting herself move freely in this church, and Jeff coming and joining us to play music, and God, and you know what? If you got a poem If you've got a scripture God's placed on your heart and throughout the week, like I've said before, this isn't all about Roxanne up here. We all is the church, all of us. I want you guys to use the gifts God has given you. You may just feel like standing up and saying something God's placed on your heart. Raise your hand and do it, because I guarantee you somebody else out there needs to hear it. That's how the Holy Spirit moves. Allow Him to press your heart to love. Allow Him to press your heart. Whatever He's putting in there, let it out. Let it out. We're to move forward, not stay where we're at. Come out of that shell. You're supposed to blossom into a butterfly. Stop being that old worm. Amen? Stop being that worm. You're made to fly, honey. You're made to dance. Use what God's given you.
Hallelujah.
With that, let's close. Hallelujah. Father, I want to thank You for the wonderful music today, Lord. We just hope that You receive that as a sacrifice of praise to You, God. And Lord, I want to thank You for the testimony, for the awesome things You've done in Brian's life. I know, Lord, that You're working and You're moving. And I want to thank You for the jail ministry, Lord, and what is going on in that ministry, Lord. The girls are just coming alive, and the men too, Lord.